Thank you. We will keep this very informal. I know this is the first panel session that you have, an opportunity to ask lots of questions. But as I agreed with the panel, I will start off with one simple question. How did you get into this career and what keeps you going at it? I gave them maximum 10 minutes each, so I will be brutal. If they go over the 10 minutes, I will say stop, right? Shut up. So that we have enough time afterwards for the number of questions from the room. So think about your questions. We have the mics in the alleys, and so think about your question. And we have about an hour and a half, so if I calculate well, we should have about 30 minutes for the Q&A. So can I start off with the panel, and maybe Leslie at the end, from the farthest away from me. The question is very simple. How did you get into it, this, and what keeps you going? What is the passion that drives you?
So those are all very good questions. but maybe more difficult to answer. So I think I've always been interested in and excited by science. So as a child, I liked things a lot, which showed that in a very simple rules explain complex phenomena. So I liked the fact that you could make a little thermometer from a medicine bottle and you put a tube in and a droplet of water, and somehow where the water drop landed was proportional to the temperature. So I liked things like that. So certainly I grew to appreciate the generality of science. The fact that simple mathematical rules explain so much. But maybe as far as what makes one go on in science, something which also I think fascinates me and maybe inspires me to try to go on is aspects of the process of science. The fact that science is a very big enterprise. Obviously, there's something about nature which makes science possible. But equally fascinating is the fact that mere mortal humans can make progress. That somehow progress can be made in steps which we're capable of.
What made you choose an academic career? Because lots of us are interested in science and technology, but we do engineering and we go into companies. What drove you to go into an academic career?
Well, I think the kind of questions I was interested in. So I suppose I was interested in the usefulness of mathematics to explain more complex phenomena. What I was going to say about the process of science is that so it seems to be a combination of I think successful science seems to have become two halves. So this is at least my internal reflection. So on the one hand, you have to be childlike and naive and ask very simple questions and have a common sense view of the answers. On the other hand, just pure amateurs have a poor record in making big progress in science. So science also has this technical side, so we have to be masters of some technical stuff somewhere to do science. And some of the interaction of these two has always fascinated me. To solve an important problem, so there's kind of problems I've worked on. What I've noticed myself is that I've bounced between these two kinds of thinking. So you have to decide what's worth solving, what needs to be solved. So you need some common sense question to ask. But of course, many people have the same answer to these common sense questions. So then you try to do some technical work. So in my case, there's some mathematical construct there. And then I ask some question about the mathematical construct, and by turning the handle in some mathematical way, I get to a point which I wouldn't have thought of by pure intuition. So this mathematics has given me a point which isn't obvious at all, and kind of surprises me. Talking about it. Now I think about it more intuitively, common sense, and then again, maybe some technical question arises, and then you go to the technical side, and you turn that handle, and again, you get to some surprising place. So somehow this is the extent to which I can analyze the fact that mere mortals in a small number of steps can somehow make discoveries of which are surprising having some technical skills are clearly essential, but just being master of technique isn't enough. You need so I'd say this mechanics of science is something which...
And why mathematics? Why mathematics?
Why mathematics?
Why did you choose mathematics?
Well, I think I don't think I was conscious of it. I always had mathematics as kind of as background, with something which was there and which I liked. And then I think I was excited by the applications of mathematics. And
okay.
Mathematics was powerful. So the interplay between mathematics and what it was used for, I think, was what
it was going. Were you a math star at school?
The question is, were you a math star at school?
Yeah, I was good enough, yes.
Okay. Barbara, the same question for you. How did you got into this career? Why academics or academia? What keeps you passionate about it today?
So I got into computer science by accident. I did mathematics as an undergraduate at college. And when I finished my bachelor's degree, I realized that I wasn't ready to go on for a PhD because I didn't feel like I had the passion for it that I should have had. And so I decided to get a job, and I got a job as a programmer. I didn't even know computers existed. This is in 1980s. They did exist. And there were definitely people. I was at UC Berkeley. There definitely were people there who were playing around with computers, but it wasn't a technical field that you study. And my family didn't include scientists. So I discovered computers on my first...
Keep the mic a little bit
closer. Yeah, I'm sorry. I discovered computers on my first job, where I was handed a Fortran manual and given a program to solve. I'm fundamentally self-taught. But what I discovered was this field that was just perfect for me, because it included the mathematics that I had as a background and the ability to be an engineer. Now, I thought I wasn't an engineer. When I got my job at MIT, Bob Fano, who hired me, said, "You're an engineer." It was news to me. But in truth, I am an engineer. Most computer scientists, at least a large fraction of them, are engineers, and I like to build things that work. So the fact that I'm building practical things, as well as thinking carefully about them, is what motivates me to go on. And like many computer scientists, what I look for is the opportunity that is arising from what's happening technologically and what problems that is opening up. And then I tend to jump on a problem that I think is really interesting and hard, and that's what keeps me going. I just love solving problems.
Were there ever moments that you doubted that you had chosen the right?
I never doubted. It's always been so clear to me that this was the right field for me. And I actually think, for those of you young scientists, this is what you need. You need a field that is both something you love, so the work is really interesting, but it's also got to be a field where you have whatever's inside you that enables you to do that work. So I happen to have inside me the ability to do this kind of engineering work, and I happen to really love the problems that I'm working on. And I tell my students at MIT, the undergraduate advisees and so forth, you know, this is what you have to do. Just because you came in and somebody told you you should major in X doesn't mean that Y isn't a better place for you. It might be that you like it better. It might be that you're just better at it. It doesn't mean you're stupid. It just means everybody has their own abilities. Everybody has what they like, and you need to find the two things that go together, and then you can do great work.
How do you choose the problems you like to work on?
Well, as I said, so that's a very hard question to answer, because people are always asking me, how can I choose the problem to work on? And I don't know how to answer that. I just look for opportunities. I try to avoid incremental work. So when I finished the whole line of research on data abstraction in Clue, I could have continued working in programming languages at that point, but I felt that I didn't have another great idea. And so I read a paper by Bob Kahn. Bob and Vint worked together on the internet, and I heard about how there was this dream of distributed computing, and nobody was doing it, and I thought, oh, there's a really great problem. So I just jumped into it. So that's been, and then later on I jumped into replication technology so that you could ensure that your data doesn't get lost even if the computer that stores it is down and so forth. So I just look for problems and then I jump. And I can't tell you how I do it, I just recognize them.
Do you have sometimes the feeling that the problems choose you?
they certainly seem to be there when I need them, so maybe they do.
Leslie, how do you choose the problems you want to work on? Can you use the mic? And don't be scared of the mic.
Yeah, I can't give you a good answer to that. I keep moving on to new problems, but I think I choose problems where I think I've got background in intuitions. I don't choose problems where I know I've got nothing to say about it. It's some combination of deciding what needs to be done and what I think I can contribute to. I find some intersection of those two.
Yeah. Tim, same question. Why did you choose this career? What keeps you passionate about it? What keeps you going?
I think I didn't really choose it. I think I was chosen. Or rather, I just drifted. Yeah. Unlike the other two so far, the only exam I ever failed in my life was a maths exam. I'm really useless at maths. And so that was one good thing. I knew I wasn't going to be a mathematician. And on the other hand, when I was about, I don't know, 11, 12 years old or something like that, we had science lessons in school, and they were much the nicest lessons. There was only one a week, and I used to really look forward to that one science lesson. And this particular term, the exam was on biology, and the whole school took the same exam, and I came out quite near the top. I mean, not top, but, you know, like 11th or 12th or something like that. So I realized, I hadn't worked for this exam. It wasn't the kind of exam you worked for. I just did well at it. So I realized that I was a good biologist. And that was a tremendous boon. I also had a friend who was a really good physicist, and I could see I wasn't as good as him. So I didn't like sort of country nature walks. I didn't bird watch or collect plants or anything like that, but I just... And then later on, I became very good at chemistry, and I think I was incredibly lucky, actually, because in school there was... I grew up in Oxford, so I grew up in an academic environment. You know, my dad was a medieval historian, and the house was always full of medieval historians, and I didn't understand. You know, I was useless at Latin and Greek, too. I had no gift for languages either. That was another good thing, I suppose. No temptations in that direction. And but I was always very curious, and I loved sort of things. You know, in those days, there was a lot of war surplus components. We're talking about the 50s now, and if you took a radio apart, you know, it had stuff inside it. You know, and you could see the variable capacitor, and you knew what it was, and you could build little radio sets yourself with a crystal, and you looked at circuits, and, you know, that. And I'd love to have been good at that, but I wasn't, you know, so... but I was rather good at chemistry, and then I heard that we were allowed to go to extramural lectures, which were run by the University of Oxford, and one of them was on Darwin. Very nice series of lectures. And then there was another one on the biological effects of ionizing radiations, which sort of initiated a lifelong fascination with and horror of Hiroshima and all that stuff. It was really interesting, actually. We're still, you know, in many ways, not out of that particular wood, actually. But anyway, and then there was another which really inspired me, which was a biochemist gave a talk. And he had a movie, which must have been made in America. Only in America would you make such a movie. And it sort of displayed these compounds flowing through these great pathways. And I thought, wow, that's amazing. But you know what? There's something missing here. There's no control. And I longed to understand what controlled the flow of those chemicals through those pathways. So then I went to Cambridge, and, you know, boy, oh boy, was I ever lucky there, because it turned out molecular biology was just in its infancy. And we had lectures from Sidney Brenner, who you heard. We had lectures from Fred Sanger, who figured out how to sequence DNA. Francis Crick was just around the corner, and so on and so forth. So, I mean, you know, and what was great about knowing all these really pioneering Nobel laureates was that you could see that you weren't that far from them. They were much better than you, obviously. Nevertheless, you could also see that you knew some stuff that they didn't know. I mean, you know, that So that was kind of encouraging, you know, it was very encouraging. And then, you know, I remember the first supervision of it was with a zoologist, and he asked us, what do you want to be? And we all said, very nervously, you know, we were absolutely overawed by the situation. He said, well, I think, sir, I would really like to do research. Now, we didn't know what research was. We didn't know if you got paid for doing research or anything. But we, in those days, we had a curious, we're talking about the early 60s now, so a curious confidence that the Lord would provide. It was, you know, I suppose in some ways well-placed, in some places not so, but, you know. And so I just went on. You know, all you had to do was pass the exams, really. If you passed the exams, you went on to the next step. And then, you know, who is it, who law that says, you know, you reach your state of maximum? Parkinson's law, yes. Yeah. So you just, you know, eventually you sort of, you hit the wall. Anyway, I was quite good at it. And in terms of finding problems, that was always just a matter of luck, actually. You know, my first really good problem came from watching a very distinguished biology make not a silly mistake, actually, it was rather a complicated mistake, but amazingly, you know, we graduate students thought we could do better than this great man. And indeed, we could.
That's promising for you.
So, you know, and then I think it's just a matter of, you know, good problems in my field take around about 10 years to solve, I would say, something like that. You know, often you had to wait for techniques to develop and things like that. What keeps you going is just that, you know, well, let me tell you another story. So I knew a guy called Stan Cohen from Vanderbilt, who was a Nobel laureate in, I think, 1988 or early 90s, something like that, for discovering epidermal growth factor. And he and I taught a course in Woods Hole in 1977. And after I hadn't seen him for years. We used to play tennis together, go cycling together. And I went to visit him. I happened to be in Nashville, and I went to see him. And by this time, he was 70-something years old. And I found him in the cold room with his white coat on. And I said, God, Stan, what the hell are you doing here? You know, you don't need to do this. He said, Tim, he said, it's pain and suffering. Pain and suffering. I just can't stand not knowing what the answer is. And I pushed you around, and every 10 years or so, I found out something good. And indeed, he just published a paper in Science, you know, and he had found out something good at this advanced age. So I think that's it. You know, you really, it's irritating. You know the bloody thing has a solution. It's probably going to be really simple when you see it, but it's so foggy now, you just got to keep pushing, pulling, tweaking at the margins all the time and keep going. But with that one obsession, I think it's tremendously important to just have one really, you know, something that occupies, well, not every waking minute of the day, obviously, but something that obsesses you.
You never think about retiring?
Well, I am retired now. It's great, actually.
Which means
couldn't recommend it. I'm so glad I'm not your age anymore, because it's so hard. Actually, my wife, flying out to Stockholm, found herself sitting next to Fred Sanger, the great Fred Sanger, the late great Fred Sanger, and she introduced herself, because obviously he didn't know who she was. And he said, oh, I was so happy when I could retire, he said, because it was so hard. This is a man who won 2 Nobel Prizes and should probably have won 3, actually. So hard, it is. It's tough. Don't kid yourselves.
Finn, you have a slightly different career, I would say. Perhaps you can tell us what drives you, why you choose what you've chosen, what is the passion that keeps you going today?
So first of all, I loved all these comments, and I resonate with all of them. The word curiosity, I think, is very important here. I feel this innate curiosity. I hope I never grow up. I mean, you know, growing old, you have to do, but growing up is a choice you can make. Stay 12 years old. So for me, curiosity has been a real driver. Why does this work this way? How does it work, and why does it work that way? And as a young guy, I used to take our household equipment apart, the vacuum cleaner and the washing machine, because things would get stuck, and I would take them apart, put it all back together again. I usually ended up with an extra nut or something, but it still worked, which impressed me with the resilience of these things. There's a theme in here. At a young age, I realized that I loved mathematics. When I was 10 years old in the fifth grade, I complained to my teacher that there must be more to this than, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and fractions. And the teacher said yes and handed me a seventh grade algebra book. So I went home and I worked all the problems in the book. And I loved the word problems more than anything because it was like an Agatha Christie novel. You had to figure out what was X. And I've always loved word problems because you are forced to figure out how to create a symbolic version of the story, which you can manipulate with mathematical rules and which produce useful and interesting insights. And so for me, math was a big deal. I enjoyed chemistry as a kid. I had a Gilbert chemistry set, and it came with chemicals that you'd never get today, like potassium permanganate, which when you mix with glycerin is hypergolic and all this other stuff. We made nitroglycerin. That was stupid. We're lucky that we didn't kill ourselves. But it was all very fascinating. And so I enjoyed, the math and the chemistry and the physics in high school. But I was really, really fascinated by mathematics. So I went to Stanford as an undergraduate and took a mathematics major. And sailed through until I got to my senior year, and I was taking Riemannian geometry. And I actually did not do all that well. I passed the course, but I remember feeling like I had broken my pick on Riemannian geometry. It was actually a graduate level course. However, during the time I was at Stanford, this is like 61 to 65, back in the Jurassic period of computing, I got to use computers. In fact, I had been introduced to computers even before I got to Stanford. My best friend, Steve Crocker, had gotten permission to use a Bendix G15 machine at UCLA. Now, Bendix was a company that made washing machines, but they also made computers that used paper tape input and output. It was primarily used for numerical control. We programmed it to do calculations of transcendental functions. So by the time I'm 17, you're all going to snicker at this, and I had to wait till I was 17 to get to use a computer. At the end of my undergraduate work at Stanford, I'd taken every computer course I could at Stanford, and I went to work for IBM. And I, for two reasons. The first one was I just thought I wanted a break from school. And second, it was a way to earn a living in computing. So I went to work in Los Angeles and ended up running a time-sharing system. Now, for all of you who don't remember this, time-sharing was brand new around 60, 61. It was invented at MIT by John McCarthy and some of his colleagues. And so I ran a commercial time-sharing system in 1965 to 67, and I got to read all the details of the operating system, which was written in assembly language. I would sit down and ask myself, if somebody pokes a button on the keyboard, what happens? And I followed what happened in the code so that I could understand how the operating system worked. Well, at the end of 2 years, I realized I didn't really know anything. I didn't know how to write a compiler. I didn't really know principles of operating systems. I really didn't understand data structures. And I said, wow, if I'm going to have a career in computing, I had better go back to school. So I went back to UCLA and did a PhD in computer science. And while I was there, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency decided to start a project called ARPANET. And I happened to be working in the laboratory of a guy named Len Kleinrock, who ran the Network Measurement Center for the ARPANET packet switching project. So I was the principal programmer there. Steve Crocker, my best friend, led the effort to develop host-to-host protocols for the ARPANET, and I participated in that. I met Bob Kahn, the man with whom I did the internet design, while I was still at UCLA. We were doing tests of the ARPANET. He would propose a problem, and I would go program it overnight, and we'd run it to see how to break the network, which we did repeatedly. And then when I went after I finished my PhD, I was invited to join the faculty at Stanford. And Bob Kahn came out in 1973 in the spring. And he had gone to the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency in the interim. And he came out and said, we have a problem. And my reaction was, what do you mean we? And he said, well, you know, we got this ARPANET thing. Yeah, he says it works with dedicated telephone lines hooking the packet switch computers together. But now the military wants to use, or DARPA anyway, wants to use computers in command and control. I said, yes. He said, well, the implication of that is that some of the computers are going to be in airplanes, and they'll be in ships at sea, and they'll be in mobile vehicles. And we can't use telephone lines to connect the tanks together because they'll run over the wires and they'll break, and the ships get all tangled up, and the planes will never get off the ground. So we had to think about mobile radio and satellite. So Bob went off at DARPA and sponsored network programs for packet satellite and packet radio, and left me and both of us working on the question, how do we hook all these different kinds of packet switch nets together to make them look like they're just one big uniform net? And so over the 6-month period from the spring of 73 to September of 73, we devised an architecture and a protocol that would allow multiple and arbitrarily large number of packet switch nets to be interconnected, incorporating ideas that included possibly new communication technologies coming along, which they did, like optical fiber networks. So that really launched a career in internet development. I was asked to come to the Defense Department, run the program for 6 years, and that was in 1976. And I have lived in the Washington area ever since, so we've been now 41 years in DC. After my 6 years at ARPA, I realized we had two sons at this point, and I did the math to figure out how much their college education was going to be, and I realized I could not pay for that as a government employee. So I said, well, to me, it's time now to go into the private sector. So I joined a company called MCI, developed some a system called MCI Mail, which is a commercial electronic mail service, and stayed there for about 4 years. And then Bob Kahn calls and says, I've left DARPA, I've started a research organization, would you like to join? It was called the Corporation for National Research Initiatives. And we got back together again looking at applications of networking, particularly things like digital libraries and digital preservation and things of that sort. And so for 8 years, we worked together on these research projects sponsored by the National Science Foundation, among others. And then I was asked to return to the private sector and to put MCI again into the internet business. So I helped build two networks, one commercial, one for research, and stayed there until the company went bankrupt in 2005. Well, it went bankrupt in 2002. And it wasn't my fault. Bernie Ebbers had acquired the company and did an $11 billion fraud, accounting fraud. He's in jail now, which is where he belongs. And so I stayed with the company until we put it all back together. We sold it to Verizon, which is a telephone company in the U.S. And I decided at that point I didn't want to go to work for a phone company. I'd already done that for 11 years. So I sent a note to Eric Schmidt, who was then the CEO of Google, and whom I had known for a long time because he was the chief technology officer of Sun Microsystems. And my note said something simply, hey, Eric, do you want some help? He sent a note back saying yes, and that was my job interview. So I'm talking to Larry and Eric and Sergey, and they say, what title would you like? And I thought about it for a minute, and I said, how about Archduke? Because I thought that sounded like a good title. So they went away, and they came back, and they said, you know, the previous Archduke was Ferdinand, and he was assassinated in 1914, and it started World War I. Maybe that's not a good title to have. Why don't you be our chief internet evangelist? And I said, well, I've been doing that for the last 35 years, so I can continue on. So if you ask what is the job, it's just whatever the hell I make up. It's really, to come back to Sir Tim's point, this focus of attention for me since the beginning of the internet design in 1973 has been how to get internet in the hands of every single person on the planet. That is such an easily stated objective that you can get up in the morning and ask yourself, is what I am doing going to contribute to that target? And so by good fortune, many, many people around the world have decided that internet is something they want to have happen. And they've spent time and energy and money, huge amounts of investments and everything else. So my career has largely been persuading people that they want to build and operate and extend and evolve the internet platform. And that's what keeps me going.
The three words that I sort of pick up from four of you is curiosity, keep on being curious, and you express it by saying don't grow up. Secondly, obsession is the word, Tim, that you use, but I hear it also in what you say, Van, the obsession of getting internet in everybody's hands, or the obsession with trying to solve problems. Three, the seeing opportunities. It's the word that two of you, also Desi and Barbara, used, sort of seeing the opportunities. It's be driven, but seeing also the opportunities to solve good problems. Is there anything I missed I missed a lot, but that is sort of very important that comes out of these four points?
The problem thing is important. Barbara, I hadn't realized that you saw yourself as an engineer. But I absolutely see that. I see why. And so am I, even though my title is computer scientist. I'm really an engineer. You know what makes an engineer? An engineer wants to solve problems. They love problems. Give me another problem to solve. The satisfaction of solving the problem is just overwhelming. And if it actually does something useful for somebody, or if the thing you built is used by other people, there is nothing like that sense of satisfaction. Of course, what Eric tells me is I'm not allowed to retire because I'm only half done. 50% of the world is not online. So I have another 3.5 million people to convert.
Yeah, yeah. Before I open it for questions to the room, there's one sort of question that I have that is to you, Vin, but maybe the others bring also some light to it. You are probably one of the few people that I know who has gone into industry and yet has kept what I will call academic freedom. The freedom to really pursue the problems that you like to pursue. And I know we're all a little bit constrained. Being a president of a university, I know how I put on constraints. There are very few people that have had that freedom of working in the industry and yet having the opportunity to actually behave and act like an academic. How did you succeed in doing that?
Sheer dumb luck would be the
I don't
honest
believe
answer.
That.
I think what has happened in my case is that the internet and all of the things that evolved out of that, the new inventions like Sir Tim Berners-Lee's World Wide Web, have turned out to be of sufficient interest both from the research community, because the infrastructure has facilitated research and the sharing of information, but also the private sector. And so almost anything that I have been able to do related to making internet work better or to extend its operation, increase its speed, or increase the number of devices that can be connected, have all been of interest on the research side and on the private sector side. And the consequence of that is freedom. And you know, if I ever wrote an autobiography, it would be called A Privilege of Life, because I consider I consider my life to have been extraordinarily privileged by exactly the freedom to choose to do what I want.
All of your work has actually had important practical implications. Any comments on that relationship with industry, working with industry? Ever been tempted to move from academia into industry?
I certainly haven't been tempted. I like the kind of freedom that I have to absolutely choose problems without having any commercial thought about them. But it certainly is satisfying to see ideas go out and influence the real world. Mm-hmm. And as an academic, it's not just the ideas that have been important, it's also the students. In computer science, most of my students actually work in industry. They do startups. Some of them are academics, but the majority are not. And that's also a very important way. That's another benefit of being an academic. Mission is that you have this influence through your students, the undergraduates also, who still write to me and tell me about how the course that they took from me has made such a difference to their career. So,
isn't that that's so satisfying when you
yes.
hear that, isn't it?
Yeah.
Leslie?
No, I've been tempted to move to industry, but I think in some areas like computer science, it's possible to find problems which are kind of fundamental in a scientific sense, but which you're pretty sure that if you succeed scientifically, it's going to find applications. So I don't think one is forced, you know. So if you really want to have impact, practical impact, it doesn't mean you have to be close to the people actually execute.
Tim, any comments on that?
Not really. I've never been tempted. We had a spell in our lives when we were collaborating with a company that sold radioisotopes, and they needed a kit which we knew how to make. And it was sort of interesting because you had to be just as smart and clever as you did in your day-to-day academic work, but the problems were sort of trivial and boring and rather repetitive, and I didn't find that very satisfying, but you made a little bit of money from it, so that was the compensation.
I have one thought that I'd like to test with my colleagues here. Some people will come to me and say, I need some help planning my career, and my answer is don't, because you can't. You know, man plans, God laughs, right? But what is important is know what you're good at, know what excites you, what makes you passionate, and be on the lookout for opportunity that lets you exercise that. And I think people with these kinds of skills, with things that you're passionate and good at, you will find things to do. They will find you. And for me, anyway, all of the interesting things I've ended up doing were not things I had anticipated or planned. They were things that came along and I recognized as opportunity.
Yeah, and it's terribly important, I think, to do things that you like doing so that work does not feel like work. It feels like fun all the time.
Just to echo, since this is another theme which has come out. So finding something which you're both good at and which you like is, as we all agree, is what you have to do. And I suppose you're fortunate if you can find it. I suppose, you know, unfortunate person is someone who is very good at something which bores them. But certainly being honest with yourself, you know, if the direction you're going on, you don't think that's your strength, the direction you're going on, you just don't like, you have to change directions.
Yeah, I was going to say something else, which is it's also important to be very honest in your work. So it's as important to understand what you don't know as what you do know. And I feel that when I read many papers in the literature, I feel that the people didn't know what they didn't know. Yes. You really have to be, and this is a kind of intellectual honesty, it's really important.
Mm-hmm. Intellectual honesty is another important point, I think I agree with. Are there questions from the room? This is a great opportunity. I know it's after lunch, but I have already two questions. Could you go to the mic or get a mic? I don't know how you...
The microphones are up along the stairs.
They're up in the alley, right?
One on
and
the left.
Maybe you can prepare yourself the other mic.
Okay, thank you for this very nice talk. It's reassuring to hear that...
Could you introduce yourself?
I am Veikko Sorjala from Finland, from Tampere University of Technology. So it's really reassuring that the career paths of just great minds were not all that linear, because mine doesn't feel linear at all. Okay. So I have a question to you, which came up several times during this talk. And a lot of you said that the way you choose problems is, well, by luck, or not very easy, at least. Now this question comes, like, then what are the funding agencies doing all the time when they're grading these kind of funding applications? Can they really do meaningful job to looking for good new things to work on? I mean, is it possible to see where the next breakthrough is going to really happen?
So is there a contrast between finding problems through luck or through some kind of synergy perhaps or whatever, and the fact that funding agencies try to influence what needs to be researched? Tim, you said no.
A resounding no. I mean, all this top-down stuff. It's okay. Let's be clear about this. If you want to build an atom bomb, then you've got to plan and do what needs to be done. That's sort of different. But in my kind of business, you know, you're just on the lookout all the time for stuff. And you don't know. I mean, That's a problem. You often ask, you know, so what's going to happen in the future? Well, the answer is, if you're honest, you have absolutely no idea. No idea whatsoever, and, because it's all just chance. And so what you're looking for, I mean, the funding agencies should be looking for people with sharp eyes and smart brains so that they can grab those opportunities.
So I think we should probably distinguish among various funding agencies. I can't speak for the ones outside of the U.S., but I'm a member of the National Science Board, which oversees the National Science Foundation, and I was a program manager at the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, and I regularly interact with our Department of Energy and others, the National Institutes of Standards and Technology. They all have programs that fund research, but there are varying perspectives and motivations. So in the case of ARPA, or DARPA now, a problem is of interest, believed to be of interest, and its solution believed to be of value to the Defense Department. Now that belief and that conclusion is reached by the people running the funding agency. And so once you get the approval as a program manager to pursue this particular area, you are generally have an extraordinarily broad freedom to go find the best people you can to figure out how to solve that problem. So it's a very mission-like character to it. On the other hand, the National Science Foundation, which funds by far the broadest range of scientific research, apart from the National Institutes of Health, which is looking at more health and biology, NSF has a kind of broad program invitation. It's trying to get people to respond with what we'll call curiosity-driven science. And they are tolerant of stuff that on the surface doesn't sound like it's necessarily very interesting. Now, unfortunately, we have members of our Congress who see some of the proposals that have been funded and say they're a waste of money. What they don't understand is that sometimes 50 years later, the knowledge gained from some particular piece of research is going to have a dramatic effect. We just can't predict what it is. Of course they don't all, but I'll give you an example. There was one research effort to figure out what it was that made male fruit flies more aggressive than female fruit flies. And of course you can imagine some congressman saying, who gives a damn about a male fruit fly and its aggression? Well, it turns out that the genetic component of the male fruit fly's genome turns out to replicate in human male genomes, I mean, which tells you something, there's a relationship between men and male fruit flies or something anyway. So the whole point was that there was an implication, a behavioral implication of this genetic element. And that turns out to be a fairly deep observation. So finding agencies that are willing to fund curiosity-based research is really important.
Barbara?
Well, I just want to return to this idea of being on the lookout for problems, because I do think that's what we all do. We're always sort of scanning for them. And I actually found a problem through a request for proposals. Yes, I did. It was a DARPA request for proposals. It was in the 90s when people began to be worried about hacking and malicious parties, and they were asking for ideas, so it was a very wide open thing. And I said to one of my graduate students, Miguel Castro, I said, why don't you go look at that proposal, see if you think there's something we could do? And he came back and said, how about the Byzantine fault tolerant? Byzantine failures are ones that are arbitrary failures, and so trying to protect against them is much harder than trying to protect against failures where a machine is either running or not running. And this led to the line of work that led to Byzantine fault tolerance, which has been a big winner. And it all came, I mean, maybe it would have happened anyway, but we happened to find it by looking at that call for proposals. So you can find ideas anywhere, and it's just a matter of being on the lookout for them.
Leslie, any comments?
So certainly this research enterprise with funding, and so it brings people together and generates discussions and some progress. But in general, the idea that some group can get together and decide which field is really going to be important in the future, I mean, that I don't recognize as anything which is in my experience of research. So I'm very skeptical of funding agencies in a big way trying to decide what the future of science is.
So, you know, just one observation. DARPA asked whether it was possible to get vehicles to drive themselves. And this is the self-driving vehicle turned into a big hoo-ha, and eventually a couple of universities, Stanford and Carnegie Mellon, won two different contests about cars driving themselves. Google hired both teams, and they're the ones that are now running the Waymo company.
You wanted to ask a question? Maybe you can go to the mic. But in the meantime, I give you the question. Please introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Peter from NUS in Singapore. And I'm interested in parts of your career where, what the most difficult parts? Where did you have any major problems, or like when you felt like you didn't know how to proceed? If you had, how did you overcome them, or what were they?
So were there difficult periods in your career, and if so, how did you overcome them?
Writing my PhD was horrible.
But and how did you overcome it?
You just have to keep going.
Yeah. Barbara?
Actually, the most difficult part was when I was my PhD student. I think that this happens for all PhD students. There's a big transition from working on a problem that somebody else gives to you to coming up with your own ideas. And there's a period in the middle of your graduate student career where you're struggling with that. And that's what I remember as being the most difficult part of the whole enterprise. Once I got past that, it was just like eating candy, I felt, you know. I would see a problem, I would start to work on it, it was wonderful.
Leslie?
Yes, the same. So the beginning is the most difficult. You don't know whether you can do research. You've got absolutely no idea what your future is going to be like. You know, so it's not that you understand what your future career is going to be. So it's a kind of you're in a total unknown, and you're just exploring what's going to happen. That's the most difficult.
So I sort of share this common experience with many of you too, is figuring out how to separate your dissertation from the rest of the universe so it's possible to solve the problem and say something fresh and new about it. That's hard. But I have had some really big challenges in the course of making the internet happen. The first big challenge is that the fact that the current protocol suite is called TCP/IP is in fact the international standard for that was not a foregone conclusion. If anything, there was an immune reaction to the idea that anything coming out of the American Defense Department should be of any interest to anyone else in the world. And in fact, there were two alternative protocol suites that touched upon this space. One of them was called X25 and X75, and those evolved in 1976, 77, 78, about the same time period when the TCP/IP protocols were being pursued for DARPA. The second one was called Open Systems Interconnection, and it started in 1978. And that was a major issue because the International Standards Organization, which is made up of many countries in the world, was pushing that particular protocol suite as the international standard. And the fact that the work was being done in an organization that had international stature, as opposed to a Defense Department project, was a really hard challenge to overcome. In the end, the OSI team spent most of its time documenting a giant stack of things about how it was supposed to work. The TCP/IP guys implemented stuff, found out what was wrong, and iterated until they got it working, and then they documented it. And so we had much more practical experience implementing things, gave away the protocol, which is, I guess, one other important point. When Bob Kahn and I started the work, we asked ourselves, should we patent this or do anything else to control the design? Now remember, it's the Cold War, and we're doing it for the Defense Department. And so we figure, you know, the Defense Department's gonna have to work all around the world, so this thing has to work everywhere. It can't just work in the US. And our allies are gonna have to be able to use it too so that things will work in the joint command and control. And then we said, who are our allies gonna be in 25 years? And we said, well, if you look back 25 years, the allies then are different from the ones that were around in 73, which are now different from. So we said, you know, there's no way to solve that problem. We just have to give it away. That will reduce the barriers to uptake. So standardization should be easier and implementation will be easier. And that's what we did. So that fight went on for 15 years until 1993 when it was finally recognized that the internet design was here to stay and wasn't going to go away.
Do you have any regrets about that? I mean, are there things that you, in retrospect, you could have done better? I mean, does it have any significant flaws?
This is question number 102. Then, so the answer is yes. Some of you may know that we ran out of the numerical internet address space in 2011. Bob and I had only allowed for 4.3 billion terminations on the internet. Now, we picked that number in 1973. That was more than there were people in the world at the time. We thought, surely that's enough address space. Well, we were wrong, because now we have the Internet of Things and mobiles and everything else. So the IP version 6, 128 bits of address space, 3.4 times 10 to the 38th addresses. It ought to be enough to last until after I'm dead, and it's somebody else's problem. So that's one thing. And the other one is end-to-end cryptography, which is vastly benefited by public key crypto. I could not fit into the original internet design because it came after we froze the internet protocols in 1978. So I would have, now we can retrofit that stuff in, and we do it now with HTTPS, for example, TLS, and some of the other crypto systems. So fortunately, we could take the advantage of the 1970s design, which materialized in real implementations later, to put them back into the internet. There's still a lot of work to be done to make this a lot more reliable, secure, and safe. But I'm convinced that we can do that. So another thing that keeps me going is making the system a lot more reliable than it is
robust,
today.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a question over there. Yeah.
Hi, thank you. My name is Phong Sathorn from Thailand. I just wonder, how do you guys manage your time to have a good balance between work and your personal things, like, you know, families and life? And also, if you're doing research right now and you want to be part of like administration or management team, how would you do both at the same time? Thank you.
How do you balance different aspects of life? And I refer to it with Horace reference with horror. If you have to do administrative work, how do you balance that with research work? Who wants to start off? Leslie, any comments on that? Want to forgo the question?
Yes, I think it's difficult to balance administrative work and research. I think you probably have to choose to do one or the other. One or other at the time. And as far as balancing, so personal life, it's probably most difficult when you're very young, I think. Then you get all kinds of pressures. Later on, it becomes easier.
Barbara?
Well, I think this is particularly a problem for women, because although I think things have improved from when I was a young woman, still women take on...
Can you keep the mic a little closer?
Yeah. Still, I think women take on more of the work that's involved in having a family than men do. So as I said in my talk earlier, I tend to work a fixed hours, and then I go home and I don't work, because I find that the off time is extremely valuable to me. And that time I was able to devote to my family. The other thing is, it's hardest when you have children and they're young, and so they need you, and you have to just figure out a balance that works. It really helps to have a supportive spouse. And the other thing is, you can't plan too much. You have to just decide to go for it. You can't plan your life, just like you can't really plan your research. You can't really plan your life either. You are going to have to take advantage of the opportunities that come your way. And you have to take a step. You know, you have to decide, I'm going to have children now. I cannot wait until such and such a thing happens. And you will figure out how to make it work. You will figure out a balance. You get very, you know, organized, and then you will figure out how to do it.
So you think that organization is really the key to that?
I do think that women who have children, they have to be very organized. You have to be able to take advantage of the time when you're working to really work. That was the other thing I didn't say. When I am working, I am really working. I am not, you know, gossiping in the halls or stuff like that. So I take advantage of that time to try to maximize the value, and then it's part of organization. So when my son was sick, my husband and I would decide who, my husband was very supportive, and my husband and I would decide who was the one who could most easily handle the emergency, and it's really important to have that kind of flexibility.
Mm. No multitasking during your job.
Your mind is always working. Yeah. But I'm not a great believer in multitasking, and in fact, I think there have been a lot of studies that show that multitasking doesn't work all that well.
Tim?
Well, I would have found it very difficult. I didn't have a family when I was sort of really working hard, and I couldn't have done what I did, I think, if I had, because the responsibilities would have been too great and distracting. And I'm not as disciplined as Barbara's. You know, I'm just too flaky.
I think lab science is much harder, by the way.
What, sorry?
I think lab science
is
harder.
Very consuming, because things take an awfully long time to do, and you know, and you start something in the morning, and often it doesn't finish until midnight, and you take off and you come back, but it's pretty tough, actually. So, yeah.
Good luck to the life scientists among you.
I didn't take much of a vacation for quite a few years, actually. Sort of stuff like that.
Vin, any comments on that?
I didn't have to solve that problem. I do have a family, two young boys. Well, they're not young now. They're 38 and 43. but they were young when I was doing a lot of this work. My wife essentially gave up her career in interior design in order to raise our two sons. And I'm deeply grateful to her and to them, because they paid a price for the 80% time that I spent traveling and working, and still do. So as I say, I was very lucky that I didn't have that conflict. I think for women it's especially hard. And we need, as a society, to recognize both the incredible worth that women bring to science and technology, and second, we have to create conditions under which they can raise families, and help, you know, childcare arrangements and all these other things should be there as a part of our societal commitment to women because of their special role in childbearing.
I have a question over there.
Hello, I'm Isabel from Australia. So one comment that you made, Barbara, really interested me, which was about the literature and how it has changed over the last years, and I was wondering if throughout your careers you've seen similar changes or different changes just in the scientific community, and I guess whether you like them or not.
So is the scientific community today different from a number of years ago?
Well,
is that an evolution?
I think if you had asked our biologists this question, you would get a different answer, because the thing about computer science is it's so young. And so when I started out, nobody had any norms about what papers ought to be like, what publishing was like. There just were no norms. So we had to develop a culture. It's really a culture. Every science has a culture about what you do with publications and research and so forth. And so it's not a question of whether it's better or worse. It's just I happen to have been in this unique position where I got into a field that didn't have any rules. And so the rules kind of came along as time went by. Now, you know, there were garbagey papers when I first started. So it's not that.
And there are garbagey papers still.
And there are garbagey papers now. So, you know, it's not really changed. But there are a lot more people now. There's a lot more papers. It's really quite a, you know, different world than it was when I started out.
Do you think that there are too many papers?
Oh, absolutely too many papers. So when I started out, you could do a big project and write one paper at the end. You would wait until you really had results. You wouldn't publish quickly before everything was known. I think now there's this huge push to publish too quickly. And I'm talking again about computer science, because that's the area I know, and it really was better before. That's my firm belief.
Tim, do you see a difference in...
Well, I mean, things have changed fantastically in my lifetime, and really fantastically. I mean, I remember the first computer we had in our lab. It was an electric
calculating machine, and it printed out the results on a paper thing in English or whatever. And if it did a division, a long division, it rang a little bell because it took so long that you needed to know when it had finished. You'd go away and have a cup of coffee, you know. So that was, and you know, the Xerox machine did not, well, it existed, but it was much too expensive for an academic department to have. And we really didn't have any of the tools we now have. The if you wanted something, of course, you went to the library. If you wanted to follow a trail of things, you had to look at the reference lists and follow those trails therein. You know, it was quite exciting. Sometimes you then had to go off to a different library in order to follow the trail to the end. And we sure didn't know what we were doing, and but we sort of, although we didn't know what we were doing, we kind of knew what everybody else was doing, because the whole field was, you know, just one field. And if you went to a meeting, you'd sort of know about DNA replication, and RNA synthesis, protein synthesis. Now we all live in little silos and we barely talk to one another. It's absolutely awful, actually, and not very interesting. We keep on going and meeting the same people over and over again. And as for this bibliometrics, I mean, that is just ghastly. But nobody has figured a way to escape from this meshwork. It's awful. We didn't have that. I mean, you know, nobody knew whether your paper was read by anybody. And that's the internet's fault. You know, you win some, you lose some.
Okay, so
do you see a difference in research culture?
So, well, I think there are some dramatic differences from what I remember, 40 years ago. What's most dramatic from my point of view is the use of computers in research. I mean, it is the modeling that's going on, it's the analysis that we can do, dry chemistry experiments and things like that, which we couldn't do before because we didn't have the computational capacity. But Meilin Feng is sitting over here. Wave your hand, Meilin, there. So Meilin brought up something today while we were visiting other ministries. And it was an observation about the way the World Wide Web works right now. The hyperlinking is one way. And so if you're looking at a web page and it says that web page or that paper is relevant to what you're seeing here, you should go look at it. But what we don't do is the reverse link. And the thing that would be interesting and insightful is to know what this paper has to say. What was it relevant to in the rest of the universe? Does it point to the places that it thought were relevant, or that thought it was relevant? Now, we use that at Google because we know all the things that point to a particular page, and we use that to say that thing must be important because so many different places refer to it. But having the ability to understand the scope of impact, the semantic impact of the content of a research paper, going back to see what was referring to it is, I think, would be of real value. And so Meilin points out that that might be worthy of exploration as another aspect of this web of information that we're all currently creating and referring to. So there's an example of an interesting alternative piece of computing technology which we might want to explore.
I have a question over there.
Hi, I'm Amy from the University of Oxford. I just wanted to touch on something from one question before. Do you think that science, the way that science is run and the PhD and postdocs, that whole kind of pathway needs to change to kind of take into account the fact that people want, they do want things from life other than just their career. Lots of you talked about the fact that without your spouse or without people around you, you wouldn't have been able to do the things that you did. So can we imagine a world in where scientists can be happier and don't have to go through those kind of awful phases? Because I'm quite put off staying in science forever because I feel like I might be able to have a family, I might be able to have those other aspects that are important to me. So do we just have to suffer through it, or can we try and change it?
Are there alternative pathways to be a top quality research scientist?
Yeah, I think this is a terrible problem. And it's not actually a problem in computer science because we don't go in for postdocs very much. We have, when I started, there were no postdocs. Now there are short postdocs. But in the lab sciences, this is a terrible problem. And I don't know how we're going to solve this. But the idea that somebody is a postdoc, and then they're a postdoc, and then they're a postdoc, and so forth, I mean, it just is not conducive to having a life. So those of you in the lab sciences.
I was a postdoc, and then a postdoc, and a postdoc, and it was a very good time in my life. I mean,
it's kind of hard to have a family.
But I had no tenure. You had 3 years, sometimes five. That was pretty cool. And actually, when I got a job, I was appointed a lecturer in the University of Cambridge. It was like a death sentence. I didn't really like it, actually. It said, to the retiring age. And, oh, Jesus, So, but that...
I think the answers must vary. You were implying that they are not necessarily the same in computer science as they might be in some of the other sciences. For me, my career path has oscillated back and forth between government work, nonprofit work, for-profit work, and I've benefited in each of those phases. And what typically happens is that I'll be in the research mode and fill up the ring barrel with a bunch of ideas and then go and use those in the private sector. So I think that it depends a lot on which discipline you happen to be in, whether you can chart a path which is productive along all the stages.
Well, that was a bit the sense of my question that I asked earlier about you have a career where you switch back and forth between business, government, as you mentioned, and universities. And I wonder whether we will see more of that in the future, whether that is a more, you're an exception if I look back over the last 20, 30 years. But will we see more of that, i.e. are companies going to invest more in high quality research, or will the research still be mainly in universities?
I wish that I could say that the private sector will be a happy home for deep research, but I'm afraid I cannot confirm that. Even at Google, the crazy stuff that we do generally does not get down to the level of serious Nobel Prize winning stuff. And many of the companies that used to do that don't anymore. AT&T is an example. IBM continues to do some pretty spectacular work, but it's a rarity these days. And so governments have to recognize that and set aside serious resources for the deep fundamental questions that research tries to answer, because that's not going to come out of the private sector.
I have two questions there. Yes.
I'm Jiaxing from Academia Sinica in Taiwan. Thank you for sharing your experience of what inspires you. So I have the following questions. How do you keep your passions in academia when the experiment doesn't work? You get a lot of failed experiments.
How do you keep your passion when experiments don't
work?
Well,
experiments don't work most of the time, so most of the time you're spent troubleshooting. But it's like, this is like gardening, right? I'm a useless gardener because I do not like weeding. But in the lab, you've got to like weeding, right? I mean, you take a pride in getting things to work because you've got your eye on the horizon, and you're pushing things to the absolute outer limit. So you've got to get good at doing whatever it is. The technique has got to be made to work. You know it can work, and you can see that the guy at the next door bench is much better at it than you can. So actually, the trick is very simple. You just go and ask the person for whom it is working and what you're doing. Sometimes the answer is quite trivial. They buy their reagents from a different company or something like that. It's really silly. I mean, you'd be amazed.
Leslie, what do you do when things don't work out, when you can't?
Well, same answer, sir. Most days things, of course, don't work out, so it's all, every day is failure, basically, except very few. So although we celebrate the few moments when something good happens, so maybe what we have in common is that we're good at being frustrated without stopping us doing. So we just don't mind the fact that most of the time it doesn't work.
I mean, actually, every time it doesn't work, it shows you a little bit of, you make a little bit of progress toward the thing that will work. So I guess, I don't even think of it as failure. You thought about this, it didn't work out that way, but that gives you an idea that...
Yeah, you've got to come from a different angle, maybe.
Yes, next question.
Oh, I'm sorry, make one other observation? If you're in the software business, like I am, most programs don't work. They have bugs. And the good news is that sometimes you can figure out why they don't work and fix that. Of course, sometimes when you fix the bug, you create others that you didn't know about. But at least that's a discipline where there's a hope that you can figure out why it didn't work and actually learn something from that, like a principle of programming that you should avoid in the future in order to not make those same kinds of mistakes. But from other kinds of disciplines, it's much harder to figure out why didn't it work. And I would guess most science advances precisely because stuff doesn't work and you have to figure out why.
Yeah. Failed experiments or failed moments are moments of learning, right? That's what you say. Yes?
My name is Faraz Zanana. I'm from the University of Lincoln. Well, there might be a lot of problems and opportunities, and identifying a significant one might be extremely difficult. But when you guys were trying to solve the challenges that you did, did at that point you had the idea that it will win you a Nobel Prize or Turing Prize or something like this?
Did you plan for the Nobel Prize or the Fields Prize?
Well, I've always had the view that all of you should want to win a Nobel Prize. It seems to me that if you're a scientist, why would you not want to solve the most important thing that you could possibly imagine that was within your grasp? I mean, this is a perfectly legitimate aim, it seems to me. Your chances, of course, are absolutely minuscule because it depends entirely on good luck.
Actually, as a computer scientist, you and I don't have the option of winning the Nobel Prize, so we're not pursuing that.
I said winning the Nobel Prize or the Fields Medal, right? So
Fields Medal. Well, I'm not sure. Fields Medal is mathematics.
Yeah, that's
computer
true.
Science is the Turing Award.
Turing
for
Award.
Example. Yeah.
So I can say that I never thought about it at all. As Ben said, the Nobel Prize isn't something that applies to computer science. But I certainly wasn't thinking about prizes. I was just thinking about...
You were having fun doing it.
Exactly, yeah. I was just enjoying my work, and prizes never came into it.
I mean, the most satisfying thing... Actually, this is a difference. I wanted to bring this up, that you said, solving problems was the big thing for you. For me, it's not solving problems, it's discovering stuff. That's what gives you tremendous satisfaction. You discover something that really opens up a whole new world.
That's the thing that NSF is so excited about, is discovery science. It's finding out something that nobody
else... And that is different.
Else.
You know, it's stuff you didn't even know it was there.
That's
you
right.
Turn over this stone and, oh, wow. So that's what...
And you know what else must be just unbelievably exhilarating, and maybe some of you have already had this experience, when you finally understand something and you realize no one else in the world understands it yet, except you. That is really something.
Yes, exactly.
I see the questions coming.
And much more satisfying than winning a Nobel Prize, actually.
I have one here, one there, and then this the gentleman over there. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you very much. My name is Harun. I'm from the National University of Malaysia. My question particularly is with Sir Ting. How you usually manage your hours during your PhD and after PhD for your research, since you have lab work? So how many hours out of 24 hours you use to manage for your team? Thank you.
Well, I can tell you.
go ahead.
Yes. We used to work pretty late in the lab, maybe 2 o'clock in the morning. So we didn't get up very early. So we'd go in and have coffee. And then by the time we'd had coffee and chatted a bit, it was time for lunch. And then we'd have a beer for lunch, and then I never understood why we could never do anything in the afternoon. So it was terrible, actually, in retrospect. We could have been so much more efficient.
Over there.
I'm Jing Xiong from Shanghai Jiao Tong University of China, and I have one question. How do you think of female scientists? Because there are so many girls engaged in the research.
How do you think about, can you repeat the question? How?
I want to know, how do you think of female scientists?
Of senior scientists?
Female. Women.
A famous scientist?
Yeah.
Well, they are famous. What should they think about themselves?
No, female. I mean, you know. Sorry, I will repeat it again. I mean, you know, many years ago, maybe girls and women are not so, so engaged in research work. But nowadays, you can. There are so many girls choose their research as their career. So I wonder, what do you think of female scientists?
So you're asking, what do we think of female scientists, or what do we think of the? I'm not sure I understand.
About the future or the career of female scientists?
Yeah.
Yes.
My first hero, scientific hero, was Madame Curie.
Yeah.
Marie Curie. Is there a difference between women and men in science? And is there a better career for women than for men, or vice versa?
Oh, I certainly don't think that there's a difference. I think men and women think women are as competent. They're not more competent. They're absolutely, they have the same potential. We live in cultures where women are discouraged in many ways. And we, as everybody, all cultures, they need to work on this problem. And it shows up in women in academia or women in research. Partly it's cultural, and then partly, there are other things going on. There's bias and so forth. And I think that things are getting better, but that we have a long way to go.
We actually do have a problem in the computer science world. I was at Southampton at their graduation exercises last year, and I watched the graduation exercises for the biology students, and there were more women than men were graduating in that discipline. And then computer science came along, and it was completely the other way around. Very, very few women and a lot of men. And I'm the former president of the Association for Computing Machinery. I'm a member of the British Computer Society. And I am really unhappy with the fact that men often treat women very badly in the computer science discipline. They dismiss them as being somehow less competent. And there's nothing, it's that, you'll pardon the expression, that's bullshit. Women are just as good and sometimes a lot more organized than the men are. And we have not solved that problem. I don't know, Barbara, whether you have any pixie dust you can think of to sprinkle on the men to get them to understand that.
What should we do to create better careers for women in science and or in research?
Or to encourage women to go into computer science in the first place?
Well, yeah. I think in the United States, which is really all I know about, we have a huge cultural issue with computer science and women. And it's pervasive throughout our society. It shows up in the television programs and the movies. So we start off with a system where computer science is shown as a career that's not attractive for women. This is not true for biology, because biology is close to medicine, it's helping people, and so there you have a much larger intake of women. That problem is very hard to solve, and it's societal, and we can't do much about it. What we can do something about is we can make sure that we treat women properly when we get them. So at the universities, we can make sure that we watch how people are behaving toward women, that we open doors for them, that we don't let these attitudes affect them. And we try very hard at MIT. Then there's a whole other host of problems I really don't understand that have to do with what happens in industry. And I know that they are terrible, and I know that computer science is not the worst, because if you read about what happens in financial companies, it's even worse. And you know, and so I can't speak globally about this. We just have a lot of work to do.
Yes, I have two questions there. Keep them short.
Hi, my name is Abhinav, and I'm from New York University. First of all, thank you for sharing your views and experiences. It's been really great to hear from you. My question is, a lot of times, mostly it takes a lot of time for an academic research and valuable outputs that come out of it. So you take a lot of lead time to be implemented in practice. And I think Dr. Winton spoke about, you know, these corporates are really acknowledging the interests of academics. And how do we bridge this gap so that the, you know, academic research and its valuable outputs can get into practice and you know, more quickly?
Any ideas about how to get research outputs quicker into practice? Tim? Your industry is a very slow one.
I have no idea. I mean, I think, you know, even academic research proceeds at a snail's pace, actually. So I don't find it at all surprising. Of course, you have a very, very good idea. I mean, like the invention of the PCR, the polymerase chain reaction, was something that received very rapid adoption because it was something that everybody wanted to do. It worked very well, very easily, and, you know, everybody just did it.
Well, CRISPR-Cas9, for example, is another good
example
of that.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. When it's really clear, I think,
you know, now, one thing that I can say is that with regard to publication, that the physics community and the archive database give an example of a very rapid preprint distribution. So internet has really helped people share information much faster than the typical hard copy printing would allow. There is, however, the other problem which has been alluded to, and that's a massive amount of poor quality stuff also getting out there. And so suddenly you have a burden on your shoulders to distinguish what we'll call crap science to serious stuff. And that's not something that we can automate. I think, unfortunately, it's going to take some kind of feedback loop where one proposal recently has been to allow public comment on published papers. And although that's very attractive, we also have the problem that somebody will take advantage of that particular channel to just spew spam and other kinds of things. So this is so hard to get right in a way that's fully productive.
Yeah. I did actually do some research on this, and I have seen that in most scientific disciplines, computer science is an exception, but that in most scientific disciplines, if there are any externalities involved in the research finding, in other words, you have to change other things to apply it, it is at least 20 years between the first publication of a paper that sort of starts the application and the commercialization. So it takes actually a lot of time, 20 years. Exemptions are in the computer science industry where things go faster, and in some medical applications where the need is so high that it drops to 12 to 14 years. But there is a lot of work to be done to speed that up. I'm going to take the last question there.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Fang Yuan from the Chinese University of Hong Kong. And thanks for sharing your experience. And but I had a question about the future. So from your perspective, what will be the most interesting topics in the future?
What will be the most interesting topics to work on in the future? That's a good question to finish.
So I think this is a problem for you. You are the young people.
Yeah, the future is in your hands.
It is in your hands, right.
Actually, I would like to challenge some of you on several different fronts on that question. First one has to do with neural interfaces, things that electronics that can interface with our neural systems. I'm persuaded that we are at a point where we can do more of that. My wife has two cochlear implants, and it's been a life-changing experience for her. Deaf for 50 years, and now she can hear better than I do, and I wear hearing aids. So that's one point. The second one has to do with understanding biological systems and their complexity and the way in which our bodies and other biological systems react to the environment. Understanding in some detail the way cellular structures work, for me, is one of the most fascinating things I can think of. We are moving into a space of nanotechnology where new materials are being created that do not exist in the real world, which have properties that we, in some cases, can tailor. In some cases, some of these structures are even self-organizing, which starts to get pretty interesting when you think about what life means. There are activities going on in the communications spectrum, no pun intended, pushing up into very, very high frequencies, 75, 85 gigahertz, there are ways of using radio communication which are dramatically better in terms of capacity than we ever thought possible, partly because we have better receivers than we had before. I could go on and on. What about some of the new instruments that are being created? The giant radio telescope in China, is the huge computing capacities that are coming, the Large Hadron Collider. We're pushing the limits of our ability to measure what's going on in the real world and then to extract insight from that. So I envy every single one of you, in spite of the fact that you may be struggling with either postdoc or PhD work. But you're at a point in the 21st century where you have more technological horsepower at your disposal than any people ever had in the past. So you should take advantage of that.
There's always that an awesome responsibility. How about making batteries as small as mitochondria?
Boy, well, it's going to be, I don't know how I would pick those, put them in my hearing aid. That sounds really hard.
Well, you can sort of build them into larger assemblies.
I mean, I've got these little things here. It's a really interesting idea. If I could build the hearing aid into my ear and drive it with the mitochondria, that's a deal.
Leslie, do you have a comment on this question?
Well, yes, I think it's, yes, the problem is for you. I think as far as the future of science, I agree that overall, the prospects of exciting research for science across the sciences is probably as good as ever. So the cumulative opportunity is probably as good for your generation as for any other generation. But the challenges are also significant, which some of your questions refer to.
It's a sort of last question and a very short answer. Something that intrigues me always is how can we, I mean, all of you sort of were referring to the fact that when you were young, you were interested in whether it was biology or you wanted to take radios apart or whatever you would, sort of the passion that you have as young people. Do we need to do something to stimulate interest of our young people? And I'm not talking about them, but the younger ones, right? The 10, 12 years old, to stimulate their interest in what we call usually the STEM disciplines, science, technology, engineering, medicine. Do we need to do something there? And what do we do?
What we need to do is to stop telling young people about science and let them do science.
Yes, I think that's right, actually. I mean, most school science is terribly boring.
Well, it's very interesting in practice, right? I happen to be one of those engineering students who love to take machines apart.
Yeah,
I usually have more than one piece over, but it still works. Yeah.
I think doing is really fun.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Barbara, any comments on that?
Well, what I start thinking about is just immense problems we have in the United States with K-12 education and getting it equally to underrepresented groups and people who are poor. Somehow or other, in the end, we have wonderful students coming out of our education system who are all geared up to do science and technology. Of course, I'm at MIT, so I tend to see them. But it's not clear to me that we have a problem with them coming out in large numbers, but we have tremendous problems of access. It's not a field that I'm an expert in, but it is definitely something I worry about.
But I was on a committee of the Royal Society, and we were supposed to be thinking about what science education could be like in 30 years' time, and we were deeply unimaginative, I think, about it. But what I did discover from my own children, was, oh, God, the way they were taught to, just lists of things they had to memorize. Dad, don't explain that. I don't need to know that. It was really awful, I thought. I know what it's like in the United States, but it was deeply dispiriting. And the books were awful, too.
Maybe internet can solve that. Yeah.
No wonder my older daughter became a classicist.
Yeah, but the theme's going in opposite directions. So some of the questions refer to the fact that science already is an intensely competitive enterprise, which makes it so competitive that it makes it unpleasant, and some people are wondering whether they want to continue in science. So the top end of research, a lot of people want to do it anyway and are competing very hard. So a question of, you know, or just putting more people to compete just for its own sake probably is not a good idea. But of course, educating the general population to science is a good idea.
Hmm. I wrote down 8 sort of statements that I picked up during the discussion. The first one is clearly no regrets. These people have enjoyed what they're doing, they still enjoy it, and have no regrets about the path they're taking, although the paths may have been different. But that's very promising for all of you, right? Because if you're at the beginning of that career, it's promising. This seems to be a very interesting and pleasant career, and I can actually vouch for that too. Secondly, there is a lot of curiosity. I remember that statement by Vin, don't grow up. And I think that sort of expresses it well. There are a lot of, how do you get your problems? Well, there are these opportunities, and opportunities can even come through grant calls, or can even come from real, I mean, needs by the government, whether it's through DARPA or other mechanisms. I sort of wrote down the word, the fourth word that I have here is obsession. Remain obsessed with what you're doing. Remain obsessed with, I want to solve this problem. Remain obsessed, I want to discover. The problem solving is probably more an engineering approach. The discovery is perhaps more a scientific approach. But both are about the obsession to do something, to understand better what is going on. Obsession combined with perseverance. Not everything will always go the right way. And so from time to time, you need to have the courage to persevere. And I understood from what our panelists said that that perseverance needs to be even higher when you are going through your doctoral dissertation. So kudos to all of you, or many of you. I wrote also down as a sixth one, the intellectual honesty. Be honest about what you don't know, and don't try to hide that, but because that helps you in being a better researcher. Is there, are there failures? Yes, there are lots of failures, and that's the 7th point I wrote down here, but failures are clearly a very good moment of learning. So if you see the failures in a positive way, they actually can help you in solving the problem, discovering the new idea, etc. And the 8th point that I wrote down is no, they didn't have a plan. There was no career planning at the beginning of how you would get to the Fields Medal, the Turing Prize, or the Nobel Prize. There was no plan. There was just sheer hard work. So I wrote down 8 things, and for those among you who come from an Eastern background, I know why. You know why I took 8. It's a lucky number. Probably they were a bit lucky too, but they didn't talk about that today. Please give them a warm round of applause for what they said.